Sit back, enjoy, be inspired. This is Fox, Brutal Fox, and he's badass. You know what I'm saying? Watch it. Enjoy.
British muscle man Bertil Fox, twice winner of Mr. Universe, was once the most popular bodybuilder in the world. He is currently on death row in the Caribbean, waiting to be hanged for the double murder of his girlfriend and her mother. Throughout his life, Bertil kept secrets. He never wanted anyone to know who he really was. People saw a smiling, confident, and massively developed bodybuilder. In fact, he was a man full of insecurities. His body took him all around the world, bringing him fame and fortune. But it was to be his downfall. Bertil grew up in Kilburn in North London. His father died when he was only 14. Bertil stepped into his dad's shoes, but as a puny teenager, he was out of his depth in the role of provider. Until one day, he discovered that there was a way to mold his body into that of a grown man. Bodybuilding held the key.
Bertil was quite secretive about when he actually started, because I don't think he wanted anyone to know how long he was training. But Bertil started very, very young. He was this skinny little narrow-shouldered kid that no one would ever believe would develop in such a massive muscle physique.
Phil Toppin grew up with Bertil in North London. He remained a lifelong friend.
We both loved the sport very much. He must have been just as crazy as I was about muscle. From the time I was a little kid, I was always crazy about it, you know, intrigued about having big muscles and looking at guys with great big muscles and so on. And he was the same.
Wags Gym in East London was the mecca for up-and-coming bodybuilders in the 60s and 70s. It was here that Bertil would meet his heroes, Arnold Schwarzenegger and Caribbean champion bodybuilder Rick Wayne.
It seems like I've known Bertil ever since he was a baby. When I was competing in my heyday in London, Bertil was about 14, 15, but a 14, 15-year-old that everybody talked about.
First of all, he was a very shy person, very shy, easily embarrassed. And what he didn't know, he certainly wasn't aware of, but other people were, and they looked at him, they saw a potential champion. Bertil was genetically gifted, like very few people are.
I've never seen another bodybuilder grow that fast in my life. I mean, up to now, you know. Every year, Bertil was much bigger than the previous year.
There was a guy who seemed to have been born to be a bodybuilder. Black bodybuilders, it is generally accepted, have a problem with calves. Bodybuilders, few black bodybuilders start off with good calves. This is something we always said that the white guys were born with, the propensity to have great calves.
Bertil had great calves always.
His proportions were impeccable. I'm almost lost for words describing Bertil, because Bertil happened at a time when there was nobody else like that.
Bodybuilding was looked on with suspicion in the 1970s. Muscle men were seen as oddballs and ridiculed in the mainstream. But Bertil had found somewhere he belonged.
We didn't care that people there were people who thought we were freaks, or that we were silly, or that we had security problems. I mean, bodybuilders have gotten a shellacking from a bunch of skinny little pencil pushers who call themselves psychologists.
But they don't know.
Most of them are unfit, skinny little runts. They are getting their rocks off, these little skinnies, by picking on the big guys. Now, the big guys have no brains, and the big guys are just bloated up, insecure people. We considered that kind of criticism the criticism of threatens, you know, the guys who didn't know what they were doing, or that guys were using those lines to justify their own physical inferiority. Let me tell you this, there is an orgasmic feel, and a long-lasting orgasmic feel about working out your endorphins and the muscles pumped up with blood, and that is why I suppose that once you've been a serious bodybuilder, you never really give it up. So only we can really explain to you what it feels like to go into a gym and pump up. So let the others laugh. They will never know.
As a dedicated bodybuilder, Bertel was force-feeding himself 10 meals a day, training 14 times a week, and taking steroids to keep up with the competition. But there was another side to Bertel's life that he wasn't good at dealing with. At 20, he already had a family of his own. Sean Fox is Bertel's only son. He lives in North London.
As a child, you missed out on everything, like your dad taking you out and all the sort of thing. I never had none of that. When you had problems at school and all that, you had no one there, like a man to sit there and talk to me about stuff. There's no one there. Like, you can't have a kid and all that. And hardly spend time with a child if you're going off training in this country, that country, doing shows. You know, the child don't really see you as much as it should. So personally, they shouldn't really have kids at them sort of young ages. You should have them a bit later or not have kids at all.
Despite not being around much as a dad, Bertel always supported his family financially. He worked as a driver on London Underground.
He would say to me, "Roman, I hate running up and down those fucking tunnels like a rat." It was always just part of his plan to do it, you know, to use London Underground and use the job for as long as he needed to. And he would say, you know, "Boy, I'm going to chuck all this in and all these suckers, then one day they ain't going to see me and I'm going to be off and I'm going to hit the big time."
By his mid-20s, Bertel had won almost every title Britain had to offer. He was Mr. Midlands, Mr. Britain, Mr. United Kingdom. Bertel's relentless pursuit of muscle had made him the best-loved bodybuilder in the UK. Thousands of fans flocked to see him when he entered Mr. Universe, the toughest and most prestigious British title.
1978 was a very, very significant year for Bertel, because he came up against the best opposition, I think, that he had met up to then. One gentleman in particular was Serge Newbray.
Newbray looked good, he was on form, he was very sharp, very muscular, very classical, beautiful package. But, you know, I'm getting goose pimples now just thinking about it. When Bertel presented himself, bang, he would hit them with the most muscular, and that set everybody off.
First of all, it began with the thumping on the ground, or the foot stomping, and it rose almost to a crescendo.
Bertel's fans began to chant, and a phrase that would stay with bodybuilding forever was born.
It's become an expression now that's used quite a lot. You may have heard the expression beef, or beef it.
Beef it, yeah. That's what they used to say, beef, beef, beef it.
Beef it, Bertel, beef it.
Bertel's fans, afraid that the judges might give the title to the more experienced Newbury, surged forward chanting Bertel's name.
They gathered around the judges and they pushed the judges forward, and it was quite scary. Screaming, "Beef it, Bertel! Beef it, Bertel!"
The judges dared not deny the man of the people the title. At 27, Bertel became Mr. Universe.
Bertel's name was spread throughout the land, throughout the gyms. He was like a messiah in a way, you know. And they loved him.
In the bodybuilding world, Fox was a star, but Mr. Universe still drove trains for a living. There wasn't much money in bodybuilding, but there was an element of glamour. Bertle could have his pick of young, attractive girls. One woman in particular set her sights on him. Her name was Kim, and she would mark his life indelibly. Within 3 months, Bertle had left his girlfriend and 3 children to marry her. But Kim's influence didn't stop there. She wanted Bertle to move to America. He had been offered a contract by Joe Weider, the biggest promoter in the world. But Bertle had reservations about American bodybuilding.
Bertle gave me every possible reason why he didn't want to go to America, Americans. He gave me all the English cliches. America is too much of a rat race. These guys are too much into making money. It's racist. He's a black guy. He's more at home in his little pool in London.
As a champion bodybuilder, Rick Wayne was already contracted to Joe Weider's company. Joe asked Rick to persuade Bertle to come to the States.
I soon discovered that I was wasting my time trying to persuade Bertle. So I turned on to Kim, and she said, don't worry about it, I'm persuading, because she had a ways of persuading Bertle. 2 weeks later, back in California, everything was sealed. They signed on, and Bertle came over. On reflection, I wish I had never persuaded Bertle Fox to come to America.
And the man who some people say is the most muscular man in the world.
Okay, let's go. Yeah.
Bertle Fox flew to America with the world at his feet. He had a contract with a top promoter in bodybuilding. His video featured one of his biggest fans.
Well, I was from the day one when I saw Bertle compete in London at the Mr. Universe contest, and he became the big sensation, which was in the mid-70s. I was a big admirer of his, simply because he represents the traditional bodybuilder and strongman. I think that he is like the new bodybuilder to be. I mean, he is like the big time of the day.
At the age of 32, he was finally ready to compete in the toughest competition in the world, Mr. Olympia.
I think that he has a great chance in 1983 at the contest in Munich to win the Olympia. And then as soon as he does that, he will keep it for a long time because he's, of course, young and has still many years to go.
Bertle was set to win. The crowd's reaction said it all.
In fifth place, Bertle. In fifth place, Bertle. Brutal Fox, England.
Everybody knew he'd won it, you see, saying Fox nigga, all of them was always supporting him. They said he won it, but, you know what I mean, he lost it, he said he was gutted. That's his only real big regret.
In erster Platz, Mr. Olympia, Samir Banu.
After Bertel lost Olympia, he started to openly criticize the bodybuilding establishment.
You know, your whole future depends on those 5 or 10 little guys that lies there. Your whole fate lies in them. These guys have never trained. They've never worked out. They don't know what the word diet means. They don't know what it means to diet till your head begins to spin. I think the sport is our sport,
right,
and we should judge it. We should have more say in the sport that we made, because we are bodybuilding, and we should be judged by our peers. A guy would feel a little bit more better to know, well, that he's being put in 12th place by good guys, you know, than some fat guy in a blue jacket who's never trained, never done anything, who puts you and says, you should be a little bit more cut and shit like this.
Being an international judge and having judged contests all over the world, there is a plus factor, and that's the personality of the individual. Arnold Schwarzenegger sold himself to the judges better than most people. He actually said, good morning, gentlemen, how are you? Nice to see you again, lovely faces. And he came forward. I said, please, Arnold, it's lovely to see you, but get back in the lineup, please. He projected the personality. Bertel didn't. He figured that if he had the physique and all that went with it, and he presented it, that was good enough, but it's not.
But Bertel is not an exhibitionist. This is it. He would call bodybuilders crawlers that do that sort of thing. You know, he can handle that.
Because Bertel knew he was better than those guys, but he lacked what it required to go and stand next to them on a stage. He couldn't handle that. So those people knew Bertel was a phenomenon. They knew Bertel was better than they were, but they soon discovered that Bertel did not have self-confidence.
According to Rick Wayne, Bertel's resentment of bodybuilding was rooted in prejudice.
Bertel Fox hated white people. He just hated them. He always felt that they were trying to use him. The guy was in a sport controlled by white people. Joe Wheeler is white, Jewish. The people who own the magazines are all white. Bertel was wrapped up in an inferiority situation where whites were concerned.
It was during the months after Bertel's failure at Mr. Olympia that Rick noticed things weren't going well in Bertel's marriage with Kim.
He would do things and come to my apartment and tell me, I wish I hadn't done that. What made me do that? Like when he beat up Kim. There were times when Bertel would ask his wife to go buy him stuff from the supermarket, stuff that no amateur bodybuilder would even dream of eating because of the immediate effect. Salted cashew, for example. Bertel knew he shouldn't be. But he would send her to buy 2 or 3 tins of it, huge tins. She refused because she had learned enough by then, telling me he'd beat her. She would have to get it. If she went and gotten it, and got it, he would beat her too. So Bertel had, but he would always be so sorry, which I suppose is classic behavior, classic bachelor's behavior. You do it and then you're really sorry and sick with himself. He'd come to my apartment and cry. I would have to talk to Kim later on and, you know, tell him to be patient and all that kind of stuff. But the guy was I discovered in the States, a time bomb ticking away.
The pressure was on Bertel to compete for Olympia 1984. But during training, he suffered a huge setback.
And they got this call. To my surprise, it was Bertel. He said, "Hey, Matt, this is Fox." And I said, "Oh, hi." And he said, "Have you heard what happened to me?" I said, "No." And he told me Kim left him. He just told me that he was preparing. And Kim called and said, "I'm leaving you. And I've left the apartment." So he just packed up everything, went back to California, just ceased his preparation for the Olympia, the up and coming Olympia, head back to California, and she was gone.
So Berger walked into my place all depressed. I don't know if I should get into the contest. Maybe I should get a doctor's certificate, seeing I'm ill, all of that stuff. I says, "Come on." Went into my bathroom, put a full-length mirror there, and I had him take his shirt off. Berger looked absolutely out of this world. I had him doing his favorite pose, which was the most muscular pose. Here we do this, all the muscles together. He went from pose to pose, arm shots, back shots, and out of this world, abdominals and everything, and doing it aggressively, the sweat pouring down his body. Finally, toweled himself and put the shirt back, and I said, "Bert, you look fantastic. You look, you, nothing can stop you." He agreed, walked out of the room, went into the living room, and he says, "But you know, I only look that way in your mirror. I don't look that way in my mirror." It almost sums up the war that that man had with himself. He broke the contract and did not compete. And he did, in fact, get a doctor's certificate saying he was ill. But he did not compete in the contest.
Bertel kept competing throughout the 80s, but never achieved the form of Mr. Olympia 1983. At Mr. Olympia 89, he didn't even make the top 10.
You've had some disappointment and setbacks during your career, no doubt. What is it that keeps you going?
It's love. It's hard. I've had more setbacks. I don't think they can do anything more with Bertel Fox. You know, I turn up in shape, and I turn big, they say, "Oh, you haven't got enough cuts." When I turn up at cut, they say, "Oh, he's too lean." Because these people can destroy you. They can play trick with your mind. You can be in great shape, and they go up there and they ignore you.
Hey, tip for fuck's sake. Yes.
Bodybuilding is something that I love, and that's what's keeping me going. Not the fame and all this bullshit of walking around like some of these prima donnas, these little shit who win a little contest, and they go around like they shit don't smell and things like that. You know, what keeps me going is love.
Right, nice, yeah. Oh, shit. Oh, man. Oh,
how about this 91? Competition, ideas, plans?
I don't know. I've got one or two ideas, but I always find, you know, that when you talk about things, they never come true. I'm a very unlucky bloke, unfortunately. And all through my life, you know, I should have been overall Mr. Olympia years ago. For some funny reason, there's always some obstacles in my way. So I have a rough idea what I would like to do, but at the moment I just sort of keep it to myself and just hope that it works out.
Bertel did have a plan. At the age of 42, he retired from bodybuilding and returned to his birthplace, the paradise island of St. Kitts in the Caribbean. It was to be his most unfortunate move yet.
Thank you.
Virgil Fox retired to St. Kitts in the Caribbean in 1992. He wanted to give something back to the island of his birth and train up the young men to become champion bodybuilders. He also thought that by returning to St. Kitts, he would finally find somewhere to fit in and get the respect he deserved. Bertel bought some land outside the capital, Basseterre, and started to build his dream home and gym, sinking every penny he'd ever made into the construction.
He was this big movie star. Everybody looked up at him as Mr. Universe. He's living in St. Kitts. I mean, everybody would have liked to meet this man. So he was like, as we said, one of the top class. But he was not what we thought.
A local girl caught Bertel's eye, a swimsuit model called Leoka Brown. He was 42, she was 19.
Bodybuilders like people in the prime of their time. When you're as perfect and fit and hard like Bertel Fox, you want a woman close to that. You can only get that at 19 and 18. Bodybuilders are physical oriented. Bodybuilders are not into soul and mind and whatnot. First, he sees her physicality. How many kids does she have? Is she in shape? What turns him on is not that she's a woman. She's a woman in great shape.
Our first contestant is Miss St. Kitts Brewers Limited, Leoka Brown. This evening, Leoka appears in a sparkling swimsuit entitled The Last Sunset. The low scooped back line highlights Leoka's well-sculpted back and a true model perfect figure.
Typical of Bertel, he would not go find himself some girl in St. Kitts who was a homebody. And look what he went and got himself, a model who was interested in a modeling career, photographs of her on the beach in teeny little bikinis. Bertel was, this is exactly the opposite of what Bertel Fox needed.
I don't see why he went out with them sort of girls. He used to like them sort of girls, the pretty sort of young girl. I sort of messed him up, He liked them sort of girl, but at the same sense, he couldn't stand the arguments. Like, he don't like people talking back to him, so that's where you can get loggerheads with him.
Leoka's older brother, Rodney, used to live with Leoka and their mother, Violet.
From what I knew, it didn't have a bright future. As far as what my mother thought about the relationship, she felt like it was a very bad idea, partly because of the age difference and she knowing Leoka, knowing that she probably wasn't ready for a relationship of that, that status, that size.
Leoka's aunts, Denise and Pearl, run a shop called Style and Style in the center of Basseterre.
He was a controlling person, wanted to dictate her life, tell her where to go. He used to even stop her from visiting her family.
Leoka, do you think that women are given a fair deal in our community?
On a personal basis, I don't think so. We are still looked upon as not being as equal as men. But on a professional basis, we have moved ahead quite a bit. We now own our own businesses. We are doctors, lawyers, judges. We are no longer in the dark ages.
All right. Thank you very much, Leoka.
Leoka moved into Bertel's house despite her family's disapproval. She lived with him for 2 years. Their home life was often troubled, and there were rumors of Bertel beating Leoka and of Leoka cheating on him.
When Bertel first met Leota, he was very keen on it. He told me about her and so on. A few months later, he called me and he told me that things weren't that good. She's always doing all sorts of different things. And I said to him, why didn't you get rid of her? And I told Leota that I'm perhaps the only person I really know about who inside out. And I told Leota that if she doesn't have the correct intentions about this relationship, to get out of it.
Leota's family also wanted the relationship to end. Her mother, Violet, intervened.
This is Violet, her mom. She had so much going for her, because she had started her business, and it was going quite well. She was a real good designer. I wish Leota had told us what was going on between Bertil and her, because we might have been able to help in some way. I think that, well, I know he would have hated us too, the way he hated her mother, because she knew, and she tried to get her out of that relationship.
Taking her mother's advice, Leota finished with Bertil, and she immediately started dating a white American student.
Yet again, another woman has done it to him. Because that was the paranoia. White people doing it to him, his wife did it to him, and this girl has done it to him again, with a white guy. And that was enough, if you know Bertil Fox. That would have been enough to blow him right out of the sky.
At first, Bertil seemed to take the news well. He remained on good terms with Leota. He returned to England for a break and asked Leota to look after his home, his possessions, and his gun.
I didn't know Bertil did have a licensed firearm. When I was in St. Kitts, he told me he was going to get one because the house was out there on its own. I told him not to. And he said that he's going to need one because he's going to be living over there by himself. The next house is several hundred yards away from it. But I didn't know he actually acquired one.
On the 27th of September, 1997, Bertil came back from his trip to England. 3 days later, he visited Leota at her mother's design shop. Only Bertil knows what happened next.
Well, about 10:16 a.m. on Tuesday, the 3rd of September, 1997, we received a call by the 911 emergency line that two persons had been shot on Keon Street, near a place called Karen's Fabric. It was a shock to me that two persons had been shot, and my first thought was probably might have been some person involved in the drug trade or something. But the thing that was domestically related was the last thing on my mind.
I was in town working with a friend, and then someone came down and said, the muscle man just shoot a woman. And then I said, who is this muscle man? And he said, Bertil Fox. He said, but is your friend? I said, yes. I said, oh my God, just like that. I said, oh my God, Foxy finished. Just like that, you know. I said, I'm so sorry for him.
One of my co-workers came and told me that, you know, my mother and sister were shot. A lot of things started racing through my mind. He told me that, from what he understood, they were shot in the leg and the arm. So, although I was extremely concerned, I felt a little bit relieved, like, okay, well, hopefully it's nothing too serious.
In fact, the injuries were fatal. Leota was shot in the back, and Violet was shot twice, once in the leg and once in the neck.
One of the nurses did call me in to take the ring off of my mother's finger, which was this ring. And that was the last time I saw her before she died.
very peaceful country. And when you hear about a shooting, it's really considered abnormal. And then you hear that two persons have been shot, and the time of the day, you know, it's 10 in the morning, very broad daylight, you know, with somebody walking and shoots some persons. So it's really, really caught us by surprise.
It was the first double murder in the history of the island. The victim's family were left to pick up the pieces.
We had to come back. I think it was the Friday. Then we came back. The blood was there still. Everything was still there, just as it happened. So the Saturday we came back and we just cleaned it up. It was awful, awful, awful.
The island celeb was charged with murder, even though there had been no witnesses to the shooting. The people of St. Kitts struggled to understand why this tragedy had happened. But the family of the dead women felt they already knew the answer.
He couldn't accept the loss. He couldn't accept her not wanting him anymore. And he felt that he had to do something. He felt like if he couldn't have her, then why should anyone have her?
Bertil was charged with murder, and everyone on the island followed the trial.
St. Kitts is a small place. Everybody know each other. When something happens, everybody hears something about it. So when they went in the courthouse, they didn't really listen to the facts. Their mind was set on what they hear on the road.
You know, there was a mixed reaction to what had happened. Particularly in relation to the mother, everybody was sorry for the mother, but in relation to the young lady, there was some things that are not so pleasant being said about her.
There were rumors going around all the time saying Leoka had stolen money from him, Leoka had fight him, have another fella, or carry somebody in his place, and all those rumors.
Around the trial time, a lot of people was kind of like building it up to be like another O.J. Simpson kind of thing, where this popular athletic person, you know, majority of people was saying there's just no way they're gonna convict this guy, and you know, he's Bertil Fox.
Bertil hired the best and most expensive lawyer on the island, Dr. Henry Brown.
I got the impression that he was very confident in his mind that he had done nothing wrong, because he was reasonably sure that he would not have to suffer incarceration for any considerable length of time.
At the trial, Bertil made a statement. He claimed that when he returned from England, his gun was missing from his home. Looking for an explanation, he went to find Leoka, who was in her mother's shop. He said her mother had the gun and had refused to give it back. A fight started, and the gun went off accidentally.
At first, I feel sorry for him, Miller, because I'm sure that he's sorry for what he did. But when I went to the courthouse and heard what he said, that it was an accident, I mean, it gets me more angry.
A few members of Bertil's family still lived on the island. His fiercest supporter during the trial was his niece, Elretha Simpson.
His girlfriend's mom and him, they weren't really on speaking terms. As a matter of fact, in my mind, I felt that she hated him, yes? So when he went there, she had his gun and I guess this pouch in her two hands, and like playing with them, saying remarks like, these you want, you know, you wouldn't get them, you know, and talking to her daughter, telling her, do not come in here with that. Now when we say something like that, that is like something awful to say to somebody something degrading, and you call somebody that in our colloquial terms here in St. Kitts. So I guess that would cause him, you know, agitate him.
He grabbed for the weapon, and as he grabbed for the weapon, there was a resistance from the mother. The weapon went off, because by that time, Layoka had positioned herself between him and the mother. And so the weapon went off. The resistance continued. The second shot went off. And a bullet caught each of them.
I want to know how an accident could be shooting two people. And he said, right, that they were struggling. The mother and he were struggling for the gun. That's what I heard. And how it went off and he didn't get no shot.
His defense was that the gun, I was resting with Luca for the gun, and the gun went off accidentally. There's no doubt that anybody other than Burton Fox shot and killed these people.
The policemen did not take any fingerprints from the gun. So they, in truth and in fact, they did not know if Burton actually came there with the gun or if the gun was there. After the first hearing came to a hung jury, you know, they had to have a second hearing. And that is when things went into action. They started having a lot of candlelight vigils and having matches for domestic violence against women, and everybody got involved.
This incident happened at a time when the country was quite sensitized to violence against women, and had formed a view in their mind that frequent violence against women should be arrested, number one. And in a small community like this, when all the women are singing one tune, it is difficult for the men to sing otherwise.
During the second trial, another factor went against Bertel. It was the very thing he spent his life trying to achieve.
He was a huge man, comparatively speaking. That was one of the telling factors against him in the mind of the man in the street, because they're of the view whatever weapons they had, given his strength and obvious physical capacity, he could have dealt with them differently.
Personally, I would not have picked a fight with him, because I think he could probably take one thing and just throw me aside. You know, so it didn't make sense. It didn't make sense.
I heard the judge say in his summation that he can't imagine a man that big running from a woman with a gun. Now, could you imagine? A woman with a gun is as dangerous as they get.
Bertel was found guilty of double murder.
Whoever is convicted of murder shall suffer death by hanging as a felon. That is unequivocal.
Bertel has been on death row for the last 5 years.
When I went to see him after they put him away, it was so upsetting to me, because when they let me in, they locked so many doors behind me. He was so sad. You could see the impression on his face that he wanted to cry. So when I came outside, I just stand up and I shake my head and I say, "Oh my God, Foxy is finished."
The Privy Council in London is the final court of appeal for the Caribbean. It recently ruled that the automatic sentence of hanging for murder is unlawful. Deliberations continue. Bertel could still hang. or he may have his sentence reduced to life imprisonment.
Both got a verdict of lifetime imprisonment. I would definitely much prefer the death sentence simply because to me, lifetime in prison is still a loose end. You never know. The roof could get blown off of the jail and he escapes or whatever. Anything could happen. You know, once you're still alive, there's life is hope. Once you're alive, there's hope.
If I sit there and think about where he is now, sometimes I might cry now and again, you know what I mean? You know, I have pictures on my wall of him and all that, but that's not as bad looking at pictures, but, you know, I was trying not to think about where he is right now. I was trying to figure the happy times when I see him, you know what I mean? That's how I get through personally. Back to seeing a picture of his old house. But I will go out there this year sometime. See if anything's left.
Where he hoped to spend the rest of his life. Well, there's only one mirror remains here. The entire place used to be lined with mirrors all around. So you can just stand here and just look all around and, you know, you can see yourself.
Bertel Fox, twice winner of Mr. Universe, was one of the most popular bodybuilders in the world. Now with 5 years of prison time behind him, he has shrunk to half his former size.
For a time, I was told he worked out in prison with buckets of water and so on, makeshift weights. I'm told he doesn't even do that now. That must be a horror. For a guy who always thought, no matter how he looked in the mirror, he saw some little guy poking back at him. Imagine what it's like now looking at himself, perhaps weighing 160 pounds. That's a man who weighed 235 of muscle. I don't even know execution can be worse than what he must be going through right now.